protecting, and as I like to say, in some ways, protecting the very idea of the NFAC in its existence. That's the real question. And the question to that is very simple. Let's go ahead and take a step back. 2020 came to an end for the NFAC on a very successful note. Six successful demonstrations of power to power, engaging the government for cases that involve police brutality, Breonna Taylor case, the Ahmaud Arbery case. You understand what I'm saying? We made a difference, and we didn't trip. We didn't drop the ball. We did nothing. Right. Then all of a sudden, here come these trumped up, these bogus charges. They come out of nowhere, which completely flies in the face of everything that we have ever stood for, or even in any of the way that I've led the NFAC. Right. Well, once that happened, of course, you know, like they say, if it bleeds, it leads. And, of course, if you remember, it was breaking news when the Supreme Commander of the NFAC was arrested and accused and all of this. It was breaking news everywhere. Then it got quiet. You notice it got quiet. Uh-huh. Well, it's a good thing it got quiet, because while we were dealing with that, the other militias, the ones that we warned everybody about, the ones that, see, most people who don't understand how a nuclear reactor works, they put cooling rods down in the water so that, I mean, they have water to cool off the rods so they don't get too hot. The water will boil, but then again, they put more water in to keep the temperature at a certain temperature so that it doesn't explode. You drain all the water out, you get Chernobyl. Everything blew the hell up. Right. If you remember in 2020, every time the NFAC manifested itself, yeah, white militias talked a little something. They was going to do this, they was going to do that. They talked a big game on social media. Oh, it was going to give it all. Uh-huh. But nothing ever happened. Uh-huh. Nobody ever fired a shot at the NFAC. Meaning we were the equalizer. Right. Everywhere we went, we were like the cooling rods. The moment they pulled the cooling rods off the scene, which was early December, by January, all those groups that had, they had nobody to fear now. Right. They had nobody to fear. They got food now. Right. Trump got them pumped up too.
Yeah.
All this had. Because there was no NFAC presence. Mm-hmm. Because we're dealing with the court case.
Yep.
You understand what I'm saying? Which was okay. It was okay, Chuck.
Yeah.
Because it gave them a chance to show us.
Exactly.
Oh, they just showed out, didn't they? Oh, they climbed the walls, put doo-doo on the walls, installed the computer. They just asked for them.
I couldn't believe it.
I could. Because I've been saying it all year. And then the wheels just all came off, Chuck. The wheels came off. They found out that this boy over here was an FBI informant. Same thing they accused me of doing. They were like, look at
the problem.
That wasn't bad enough. They ain't found out that this stuff in the Capitol, all of them had something to do with. You know whose name never came up? NFAC.
Right.
When they was running around trying to find people who had something to do with it, you know whose name never came up? NFAC. Matter of fact, when they started grabbing people and locking people up and trying to figure out, you know, who even, they went and locked up one guy who wasn't even there. They just went and got him because he helped plan it. You know whose name didn't come up? NFAC. I'm taking you through all of that to say this. After they clowned out, those same people who wouldn't talk about us took a look back and said, you know what? Damn. They really are. They're not the violent ones. Senator Cruz said during the congressional hearings last week, one of them, I'm not going to keep track because I don't like to watch the guy because I understand all that programming, but Senator Cruz, while he was testifying at the congressional hearing on the January 6th shenanigans, and he said to the director of the FBI who was on the hot seat, he said the NFAC was a violent, right-wing extremist group. I almost slid down the drain, Chuck, because my phone blew off the base, and did you hear what he said about y'all? And immediately, there was another congressman, the brother, and he said, hold on a minute. He said, I would like to have both of y'all explain to me why the FBI is looking at the peaceful NFAC instead of keeping an eye on them boys that ran committed violence. Show me where we're extremists. Show me where we're right or left wing. We don't claim no wing. We don't do that wing thing.
Oh, no.
Stop trying to fit us into a box to fit your narrative. Because guess what happened? You tried to create that narrative. It did not work. You pumped it up enough to get the feds to come after us. Okay? Then the feds have found out. What's this? Because the people they should have been looking have ran up in the damn top in the Capitol. Now all of a sudden you got to come back and be like, well, damn, we were wrong. So let's go talk to them. Now, let me sidebar you real quick. Showtime was an accomplishment that we as in the movement should really sit back and be like, you know what? You know, people need to really stop sitting around playing hating and specializing and being negative by default. And when we make progress, let's claim our progress. If you see something like that happening and you're a part of it, then you just made history. Showtime is owned by Viacom. Viacom owns every other goddamn channel on your cable dial. They also own CBS. And CBS don't tell stories like that very often. So for them to take the story of the NFAC and use it as the opening story for their season premiere on Showtime? Mm-hmm. We shot that story back in October, November. Okay. We had been shot that story. You hear me, Chuck?
Yeah.
That's why when they called me and said they was going to put it on, I went, huh? I didn't even remember what story they were talking about, bro. We shot so many. And I'm going like, whoa, don't put nothing on until I see what it is. I got, you know, restrictions. What you about to do? Yeah. And they said it's the one that you shot for your new chapter in Louisville. And I'm like, oh, well, okay. And, of course, came out beautiful. I'm impressed. Everybody, all y'all on Showtime. Ooh. Mm-hmm. But that's not what I was waiting on. What I was waiting on was the story we had just done with NBC.
Okay. Yeah.
That's what I was waiting on. I didn't even know that was coming. So it was kind of like a 1-2 punch.
Right.
So that dropped. And then, of course, this whole NBC story was serious. So y'all didn't even see the whole story. And I'm not going to release, because NBC may release it later, but there was more to it than what you saw. They gave y'all like a very condensed, you know, 3-minute, just to get the point across. But there's much, much more to it than that. So the reason that I'm talking, I wasn't forbidden to talk to media. I just wonder why mainstream media took so long to acknowledge they had to wait until they started hearing it from overseas. Mm-hmm. They had to wait until the government came at them and said, you know, we might have been wrong about these guys.
Right.
I'm not stupid. I can feel what's happening around me when I say
because these will be the guys to say.
You have to understand that now
everybody from the white militia, because these white people are killing white people.
The U.S. Department of Justice is getting
But they're killing black people too.
Now the emails of bombarding the box of attorney generals and prosecutors.
We just want to give y'all a little bit of peace of this video. We'll link the description below of the gentleman that's doing the interview. Make sure you go watch the full interview of Grandmaster Jay. Grandmaster Jay speaks. We just want to give y'all a little bit of support, Grandmaster Jay and the NFAC, y'all. Peace.